join us? Before that, the program should go ahead, and so I request on behalf of the organizers, our principal madam, to deliver the inaugural speech and let the program start. Madam, please.
Can anybody help me whether our Honorable Vice Chancellor sir has joined or not? Anyway, he will join us soon.
Not yet, madam.
Okay. He will join us soon.
Not yet, madam.
Okay. In the meantime, let's have some formality. I, Dr. Shoma Ghosh, takes the privilege and pleasure to welcome all the participants and honorable resource persons, as well as my colleagues in this webinar. Perhaps there are few students of our college or some other colleges too. I welcome them also. As we know that the world is presently facing a global health pandemic, developed countries such as USA, Italy, France, Spain, etc., are experiencing an unprecedented health crisis. Developing countries are the most heavily burdened due to their limited public health infrastructure and scarcity of resources. The pandemic has posed a challenge to their ability to provide the necessary social protection and other forms of state support that can help the poor and the vulnerable cope up with the situation. The critics are of opinion that the emergence of COVID-19 is a direct consequence of anti-people approach to science and technology, rooted in an unfair patent regime and the expansion of unregulated new frontiers that put people and planet in peril. In an interconnected global village with an inclination towards neoliberal market approach and digital data domain, spawning a global class of elites deploying technology for consolidating corporate power, the role of science and technology needs to be re-evaluated. In this unequal world, lockdown witnessed curtailment of civil and democratic rights within and across the nations. At the same time, there is conflicting interest in respect to proprietary control over the drugs. Along with research to innovate drugs for clinical treatment of corona, the global policymakers and social activists need to Our college has arranged number of such webinars to help exploring several such areas of challenges, some of which are going to be focused in this webinar too. In this webinar, we have renowned scholars and academicians with us to share their views from their treasure of knowledge. Professor Bashwat Chowdhury, Honorable Vice Chancellor of West Bengal State University, is going to lighten the lamp with the spark of his knowledge and wisdom. Sir, have you joined? Sir, could you join? Can anybody tell me whether Professor Chow?
Not yet, madam.
Okay, fine. We have to wait for a while. And before handing over to Honorable Vice Chancellor, I'd like to express my gratitude to all my teaching and non-teaching colleagues who have always made it a proud privilege for me to work with them as colleague. The faculty members of Zoology, Dr. Indrajit Bishash, Dr. S.R. Ahmed, Dr. Anindo Sundar Bhuiya, Sri Shantanu Das, Srimati Rituparna Maiti have worked tirelessly to make this event successful. Constant support has come from Dr. Pradeep Das, our Teachers Council Secretary, and Sri Pradipto Mukherjee, Seminar Committee Convener and NAC Coordinator. IQAC Coordinator Dr. Rupa Sen and Bursar Dr. Lipika Mollik, and our senior most faculty members, Sri Dibakanto Jha and Dr. Sonali Mukherjee, not to mention other names, there are lots of other people too. They have always provided help and advice to the team. Last but most importantly, I must convey enormous thanks to some of my beloved junior colleagues. Sri Ritik Acharya, teacher in the Department of Botany, Srimati Atri Vattacharya, teacher in the Department of History, Srimati Pooja Das, teacher in the Department of Computer Science, are some of the names among others. Without their technical expertise and constant support, perhaps no webinar could have taken place. With my regards to our respected president of governing body, Sri Madhun Mitra, and all out support, I'll have to request Professor Bashop Choudhury to deliver his lecture and to take charge of today's first technical session. But he is perhaps yet to join, no?
Yet to join, ma'am.
So we need to, I request all the participants to wait for a while. Haan, sir, bolun. হ্যাঁ আপনার মেলে দিয়েছে স্যার আমি আরেকটা লিংক পাঠাচ্ছি আপনি সেটা আপনার ওই যে ভিসি ডট আমি আপনার হোয়াটসঅ্যাপে পাঠিয়ে দিচ্ছি স্যার we have to wait for a while. I'll request all the participants to wait for a while. Sir, could you take entry?
Yes, madam. He has joined. Our honorable VC has joined.
Okay, fine. It is my proud privilege to welcome our honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bashop Choudhury. He needs no introduction at all. We all know that he was a renowned professor and former registrar of the University of Calcutta, spanning a period from 1991 to 2015, before joining the post of Vice Chancellor of the West Bengal State University, Barashat, in 2015. During his academic career, he, as an active researcher, worked in USA, Netherlands, South Korea, etc., as well as in different places of India. He was awarded several gold medals for best publications. He is a reflective and human vice chancellor who always takes decision, giving due weightage to the opinions of all stakeholders, college principals, and teachers. It is our proud privilege to work under a vice chancellor like Professor Bashok Chowdhury. Along with Professor Chowdhury, I'd also like to welcome Dr. Shamasri Ghosh, Scientific Officer in the School of Biological Sciences, NISO, in Bhubaneswar since 2016. Without wasting much time, with my heartfelt gratitude and thanks to all the speakers, my senior colleagues, my beloved junior colleagues, and my students, I request Professor Bashok Chowdhury to take charge of the platform and to grace us by lighting the lamp with the spark of his knowledge and wisdom. Sir, please. Professor Chowdhury, hello. Vinci sir. Vinci sir, are you there?
Yes, Lip. Yeah, joined again. Sir,
yeah.
Need,
yes. Yeah, unmuted.
Okay. Sir, I request you to lighten the lamp of this webinar.
Okay.
Your knowledge.
No, okay. Thank you so much. Can you hear me?
Yeah, you are absolutely audible, sir.
Okay. At this voice, I can speak or I'll be a bit loud?
No, it's okay, sir.
I think all
the participants can hear him.
Okay. Yeah. Indeed, a privilege for me, Dr. Ghosh, the respected principal of the college. All the other teachers of the college, which is doing quite well under the leadership of Dr. Ghosh. As she has said that for an affiliating university, it is a privilege for the Vice Chancellor to work with so many learned principals who are basically doing the same job as the Vice Chancellor in their fields. So in their fields in the different colleges. So indeed, it is a great privilege for me to have worked with Dr. Ghosh and many others who are in different colleges. In fact, they are running the colleges with a lot of mails are continuously coming, and that is why I'm getting distracted. So they are running the colleges with a lot of competence and integrity. And when this pandemic has struck us on the face in a very bad way, they have not kept themselves locked in their rooms. And even in the lockdown situation, they're innovating and they're thinking how to reach the students at different places by organizing different webinars and things like that. You know, as I am speaking this, and I am reminding everyone about this, that face-to-face teaching is the best possible method of teaching. But because of the pandemic, for the last 3 months, we are locked down and we cannot go out. And we cannot see the face of our students, although for the administrative reasons, we are going to the university and the colleges. It is basically a skeletal staff or the skeletal framework with which the colleges and the universities are working. We cannot see the students, and that is why we are feeling a bit depressed also, because students are like gods and goddesses to all of us. Unless the students exist, the principal or the teachers do not exist. If the student does not come to the college, it becomes a garden of the selfish giant. So we do not want that. We want the students to come. Problem is that this pandemic has stopped all of us from going into the classroom, because the classrooms are basically empty. And the students are also feeling bad because they cannot come to the college. You know, the teaching and learning process that we do, it is not only from the board to the student. It is a lot of socializing that takes place. It is also because of the peer system that works nicely, that when a teacher is teaching something, some subject, and the student does not understand, once the teacher leaves the classroom, the student then goes to his or her friend and asks the point that could not be understood properly. So the point is that the socializing part is being missed, and somehow we are trying to continue our process. You know, somehow we are trying to continue our process. It is not that getting locked up. Continuously, message is coming, and that is why I am getting distracted. For the next webinars and for the many other things. What to do? Anyway, so please excuse me because I am getting distracted because of the messages, and I have to read them and then continue to talk. So this pandemic has taught us how to reach the student, crossing the space and time. Crossing the space and time is basically a system where, you know, from North Calcutta to Hiralal Mujumdar Memorial College, it takes time to go by bus or by any transport, and it also takes some time. But with this system that you have now, this webinar, you are crossing that space and time and immediately can reach the Hiralal Mujumdar Memorial College, and you can see the face of the principal. This is something really good about technology. Problem is that in our country, all the students are not having this technology. But if this pandemic continues and if it creates a threat for all of us, we must have a system where we have this technology. Have this technology for many of the many of our students. We must have this technology, and maybe the building grant that government gives, gradually they will consider consider not spending money on building, but spending money on some accessory for the student with which they can study at home also. So, you know, these are some of the things, the futuristic. These are some of the things that will come. Think about the economy that has got the loss, that has suffered the loss in the last so many days. In the last 3 months, we have lost an economy of, say, 3 years or 4 years. So it is a big thing. All of you know about the virus. I am not talking about it. This is about the technology and the science behind the virus and how to contain the virus, right, Dr. Ghosh? It is about that, right? It is about this webinar is about the scientific and technological aspects of COVID-19, right?
Right, and its limitations also.
Scientific and technological aspects of COVID-19. COVID-19, this virus is not absolutely new. This COVID thing. We have seen this kind of virus many times. For example, SARS, acute respiratory syndrome, the death rate was also very large in 2003-2004. Then there was Middle East virus, MERS. That is all belonging to this category of virus. This virus is different in a sense that this virus has a lot of infective capability. It spreads infection, but interestingly, the death rate is much less. Infection is much large, death rate is much less. And the problem is, it is very difficult to really see how the infection will proceed, because it originally was thought that it started from chest infection, gradually it came to diarrhea, then skin rashes and skin infection and skin, you know, dermatology problems, then circulation problems, then loss of sense of smell, loss of sense of taste, conjunctivitis and some eye problem. So this virus is continuously shifting its nature. You know, it is something like Mahishasura Mardini, Mahishasura. You know, Mahishasura continuously changes its shape and shape and structure, and you do not know how it works. You know, it is very interesting. And we need a Mahishasura Mardini in the form of Shuma Ghosh, who will tackle this problem and who will and the lady scientist, I think what Shalmali Ghosh or someone from Bhubaneswar, she is coming. So we need that kind of able person who will put a stop to this virus. Problem is that we do not know the character of the virus very well. And because we do not know the character of the virus very well, although some statistical information have come, Professor Pratim Mojumdar of the Indian Statistical Institute has done very good work on this virus. He is with the National Institute of Biomedical Genomics. And many other scientists are working on this virus. Point is, it takes time to do scientific work. And it also takes time to do work that is reproducible in nature. And these biological systems, you know, they change their pattern in a very large way. It is not a physical system, it is a biological system. And the biological system, to maintain the strain and to maintain the, those materials at -4°C, and to maintain those materials at, in proper condition, that is very difficult, you know. And it is also difficult to work with this virus. Those who are working with these viruses directly, they are taking a risk on their life. So you must give them a pat on their back, because at this hour, when we are struggling for medicine, we are struggling for knowing the nature of the things, they are working in the labs. As United States scientists have said very properly, and also UK scientists, that it is difficult to prepare a vaccine immediately. Vaccine research is basically lab scale to bench scale to pilot scale and things like that. Very, very incremental way of doing things. Initially, we'll apply on animals, then there'll be animal model, they call it. And then they will work on humans, and they will find whether there is false positive, false negative, and all those things. And then finally, a drug is approved. And once a drug is approved, it is, when you know, the side reactions are seen, the side effects are seen, and then a drug is put to use for human use. Until that time, unless that happens, we are really in a bad situation, because there is no fixed medicine for this particular virus, and people are doing symptomatic treatment. When there is comorbidity, or when the age is large, or when the age is small, things are becoming out of control. It is not that this virus is causing only problem to old people or the very young people. It is also causing problem to a 20, 21, 25, 20, 30, 30, 40 years old people. For example, yesterday there is a news that a doctor and his husband and wife, both are doctors, their son, who was also doing study in medicine, got headache, and the doctor tried to do some treatment, and within a day or two, he just expired. So point, he is only 21 years old. So the point is, you know, it also happens that way, that this virus can cause havoc, and it has caused havoc. You see, Italy, Spain, United States, UK, all these countries are extremely careful about the health and health program and the health of the citizens. But the point is, you know, in India, with so strong, so large population and so high population density, we still have been able to manage our death rate. That is something remarkable. You know, whoever runs the government, and who, whatever political belief and political philosophy one may have, you know, I really give thanks to my chief minister of the state. I give thanks to central government, everyone, because, you know, we have done pretty well as a nation. We have really done pretty well in this situation, because, you know, in a country where out of six people, one person is Indian, in this situation, we have been able to keep the death rate lower, although our people may not be that conscious like the U.S., The population density is so large over here, still we have been able to keep the death rate at a lower level. Maybe because the strain of the virus that has come over here has been ineffective to some extent because of the sunlight and things like that. But anyway, it is very good. It is very good that that we are trying to create our own system and trying to create our own medicine. For example, Fabiflu. Fabiflu is a new medicine that has come 2 days ago. Our own Indian company has developed Fabiflu. And our doctors and our administrative people and the police, they are doing fantastic job. So, and scientists are trying to do, but people feel that, you know, that science is very quick. It is not very quick. It takes time to develop certain things. You know, nothing is very quick, but, you know, it takes time to come to that. You are talking about technological progress. Technological progress is for COVID-19 is basically, you know, the pharmaceutical companies will do that. And any pharmaceutical company, they work under the GMP condition. You know, this green manufacturing practice and also aseptic conditions are basically where there is no contamination, and also because the test has to be done against this virus, the persons who will be testing, they have to take all care against this virus. It is really something remarkable that the scientists have to do in this situation. So what I say is that, you know, the work is progressing. Actual scientists who are working, maybe from NICED, Bhubaneswar, who has come, she will talk about the virus and its nature. But I can talk, because I am a chemical engineer, I can talk about the pharmaceutical industry, that it does not work that way, that immediately things happen. We always work in small scale, maybe 50 ml, 100 ml scale. Then it goes to 1 liter, then it goes to 10, 5 liters, then it goes to 100 liter, and then, you know, it is basically called scaling up. And scaling up process, there may be contamination. And in drug research, the most important thing is to remove contaminants. You know, these days, it is not only important to have 99.99% pure drug. You must also say what that 0.01% impurity is. That impurity present at very small concentration, it is extremely difficult to find that out. See this virus. This virus is really moving around air. And you do not know whether it exists in water also. But the point is, you cannot see them. Just like that, 0.01% concentration in a particular material. For example, our milk. If you think about the milk that we consume, you do not know what is the impurity level. 99.99% pure milk, nothing will happen. But 0.01% impurity that we have, even that may cause havoc in drug, or it may lead to many, many reactions. So these days, drug design and drug reaction is not, drug development is not very easy. It all starts from the computer model. Again, computer model, because you know the virus, you know its structure. Once you know the structure, you try to find out what is the antidote. Antidote is basically what will go against that particular molecule. And you must know how that molecule works, because, you know, there is some kind of ligand. And that ligand is basically, you know, for example, you know, this COVID-19. If you can create a drug that will just make the spikes ineffective, you have won the game. The spikes, the RNA, once you are in a position to make them ineffective somehow, your virus is gone. It will not be able to create that infection, the infection that we are having. And this infection, you know, it is something that it infects in a very, very bad way. It infects a large segment of people. It does not create death, but it may create death. And if it infects a large number of people, for a country like India, with the amount or with the availability of our resource, hospital resource, it may be extremely difficult to give treatment to all people. You see, all hospitals are not equipped that way, number one. Number two, we do not have so many beds. And if with this large population goes to hospital, what will happen? The entire health system will break down. So that is why this lockdown has taken place. And because of that, the economy has suffered a beating, economy. But this country, I must tell you, this country believes in God. And this country is a country that has saved human lives at the cost of economy. I always say this. This country, yesterday the Honorable Chief Minister of the state has declared that there will be lockdown. People say, oh, lockdown. Yes, lockdown is important. Lockdown is important because you are saving lives. You are saving lives, and to the persons who are at the top of the administration, saving life is the most important job for this country. and they are doing it with exemplary courage and with exemplary commitment in this situation. I'm as an ordinary citizen, I'm extremely happy. What will Shoma Ghosh do in her college? She will not allow the students to come in this situation because she cares for the students. She cares for the children. So that is what the leadership means. You know, we need that kind of leadership at the top, so that the right decision is taken and they are properly implemented. We must use masks, we must use gloves, we must clean our hands again and again. This particular COVID-19, it has hydrophobic and hydrophilic character. Hydrophobicity is something like oil and water. Oil does not mix with water, because oil and water, but if you stir them very properly, they make an emulsion. Emulsion is basically, there are many emulsions. It is our subject, oil in water, water in oil, and you put a surfactant and you get emulsions. So I'm not talking about that. Oily surface, you know, sticks to oil. For example, a paraffin is basically oily, and that oily material will like oil material. So the point is, if you keep your hair dry and make, you know, use shampoo, there is every likelihood that you will not, the virus will not stick to your hair. So these are some of the things, you know, although there are many other protein molecule on which the virus can stick to. So all these need very careful investigation. COVID-19 is a new virus. It is causing problem because we do not know it very well. But with the amount of work that is going on in different labs all over the world, I am confident that day will come soon when we will have a proper treatment for this particular COVID-19. It may not be immediate, but it will definitely come. We will definitely be able to reduce the death rate. And in the meantime, the scientific and technological progress that will continue. Scientific and technological progress never stops. It is a continuous process. Science is something where obsolescence is very large. Science, you know, the knowledge that was available yesterday, if you look at today, that knowledge is gone. Today you are obsolete. Obsolete because you cannot keep track. That is why science is so very discipline oriented and so very deep. Deep because you cannot sit idly in science. You have to continuously do it because every day new experiments are being done. Every day new theories are being done. New theories are being developed. And once they are developed, you see things in different light. So that is what it is. Science and technological progress does not end. It continues. And it continues every minute. It continues every second. So, as I am talking, in the meantime, new ideas have been generated in some lab and new experiments are being conducted in some lab. The teacher is asking the student, why don't you do it a bit differently in this manner? And new knowledge will be created. So that is what I mean, that technological progress and scientific progress about this is proceeding. And some very good scientists, I have read that interview, and people have said, for example, Siddharth Mukherjee, who wrote that book on cancer. You know, the maladies, I'm forgetting the name. I have the book over here, just in the bookshelf. You know, you can see the bookshelf over here. I have the book, that book on cancer. Siddharth Mukherjee is in Harvard. I think he is a cancer specialist. So he was asked this question, why we are not getting a vaccine? So he said very nicely that, you know, vaccine research, it takes time, give time. In a year or two, you will find a proper vaccine. What we have, it is still not proper. Till that time, or until we get that vaccine, we have to use a mask. We have to use gloves. We have to keep social distancing. We have to reach our students in this hybrid manner, where a few students will come to college, maintain social distancing, talk to the teachers, go back. The next day, a different batch will come. Academic material will be put on web. Academic material will be telecast through webinars. Academic material will be telecast online. And in this manner, we have to develop. It will not happen in one day. Culture is something that takes time to change. Civilization needs time to develop. We must give time. Time is the most important thing. Again, time is the most essential thing, because if you lose time, you lose a person because of death. So it is a very, very troublesome situation where we are in, but the point is, I have a great belief in human civilization. You know, we have developed this. This is the war between virus and us. V-I-R-U-S and us. Virulent us and us. Virus is virulent, U.S. Virulent stuff. And that virulent stuff, we must be able to really destroy it. And we must win. We must win this war. It is basically a 50-50 over cricket match where we are batting the second time and we are losing a few wickets. But the point is, the result is known. The result will be our win at the end of the day. Because human mind is full of ingenuity. Human mind is full of ideas. Human mind is full of wisdom. Human mind is full of efforts and endeavors. Human mind is an enigma, enigmatic. And this enigma will definitely be able to fight with COVID-19 and will put a stop to this pandemic. I am confident about it. Taking time. Many people are working, taking time. Till the time we do not get vaccine, we have to really pull on and we have to innovate in different ways. I am very happy that Dr. Ghosh, with her colleagues, is trying to organize these webinars one after the other. It is very good. She could have done something different. She could have taken rest at home and taken, watch television. She is not doing that. She is bringing people from different places and organizing lectures for the students, for the participants, for the researchers. And, I am a person, when I stay at home, I always sleep in the afternoon. But, I'm on this part, I'm angry with Dr. Ghosh. Because of her, I cannot sleep today. I like sleeping in the afternoon very much. Mid-day nap is something great for me. I always like mid-day nap better than sleep at night. Mid-day nap, but because of this great principle, I cannot take this. But the point is, she is correct. I am not. So I give my regards to Dr. Ghosh. Again, Mahishashura Mordini is required, and there is a lady scientist who will come now, and she will definitely speak about new ways of killing this virus, and we must win at the end of the day. My regards to all of you, my best wishes to all of you, my prayer to all of you, prayer to God for all of you, that all of you should stay safe, take care, put mask on, put gloves on, and take good care of yourself so that you do not infect yourself. Rather, you do not get infection and you do not cause infection to others. I think that I will end my speech with that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. What should I say? I don't know, because we are absolutely speechless. Apart from being a great academician, you are absolutely a wonderful administrator. Academic leadership is something to be learned.
Dr. Ghosh, I cannot hear you.
Yes. Can you, sir? Sir, can you hear me?
No,
Okay. I am just conveying my thanks and gratitude to you. And you are a wonderful academic administrator. Your academic leadership has always been an inspiration for the principals like us, and you have always graced all our occasions in the college. So from the entire team of Hiralal Mazumdar College, I convey my heartfelt thanks and gratitude to you, and my regards to your academic scholarly attitude and your knowledge bank. Thank you, sir. Thank you for being with us once again. We'll expect that in the future endeavors also will get you as our source of inspiration. Thank you. Rehan?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, take over and convey thanks to Professor Bashup Chaudhuri, and then hand over the mic to our honorable speaker, Dr. Shyamashree Ghosh.
Yeah. Thank you very much, ma'am. First of all, I would like to thank respected principal ma'am for giving me this opportunity to introduce the speakers. Well, we all know very well, our next speaker is Dr. Shyamashri Ghosh ma'am. Well, it is very difficult to summarize her academic journey in short span of time. So I'm just going to mention a milestone of say. Well, in context of work experience, or you can say the current position, I can tell you, she is currently working in the capacity of scientific officer at the level of F, School of Biological Science, National Institute of Science Education and Research, Bhubaneswar, since 2016. Before that, I mean to say, just before this joining the current position, she was working at the same institute at the position of scientific officer at E-level since 2009. Before that, she also served as a head of department, Department of Biotechnology at Bangalore City College since 2006. So we can say she was working there, she had a long working experience. Well, in context of her academic curriculum, we can say she graduated from the Presidency College, Kolkata, in 1998 with honors in zoology. Now, after completion of graduation in zoology, she obtained her post-graduation degree in biotechnology from University of Calcutta. And the best thing is that she secured the second rank in her university in the year 2000. Now, she has cleared the CSR NET examination with JRF in her first attempt in the year 2000. The best thing is that she has cleared the CSR NET examination with JRF before the publication of her PG result. Wonderful, really, wonderful. Now, in context of her academic career, what she has done in academically, can tell you, she has earned her postdoctoral degree from Indian Institute of Chemical Biology, IICB, CSR Lab, which is CSR Lab, Kolkata, 2005. Now, she has done work in PhD, and the PhD work she has completed in 2005 in the field of childhood acute lymphoblastic leukemia, was accepted in various national and international journals of repute. She worked in the field of stem cells. She worked in the field of stem cell and nanotechnology in her postdoctoral research work. Now, she has authorized several publications in the field of including immunology, cancer biology, salicylic acid biology, computational immunology, and machine learning, and etc. Besides her publications in journals in the country and abroad, she's an author of several national and international books, which is really, if I'm going to read, then it will be really a lot, as there is a shortage of time. So I would like to request Honorable Shyamashri Ghosh ma'am, please ma'am, start your session.
Thank you, Dr. Rehan. Am I audible to everybody?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, Honorable Principal ma'am, for giving me this opportunity to speak in this forum. And thank you to Professor Bashar Choudhury, the VC sir, Honorable VC sir, for giving me an opportunity to speak in this forum. And I would like to present my talk in the form of a presentation.
Yes, ma'am.
Is the presentation audible to you?
Yeah, ma'am. We are having. Please carry on, ma'am.
Can you see the screen?
No, ma'am. No, we are unable to see your slide.
I have shared my slide actually. Can you see the slide?
No, still the screen is white. We are neither seeing you nor your slide.
Just a second.
Yeah.
I have already shared it.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, now, ma'am. Yeah, it's good.
Yeah. Fine. Yeah. Can everybody see the slide?
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. So, The talk today is on COVID-19, the global pandemic. I would focus on the epidemiology, the immunology, and the pathophysiology of the disease. I am Dr. Shyamashri Ghosh. I work as scientific officer in the School of Biological Sciences, NISER, which is the National Institute of Science, Education, and Research in Bhubaneswar. So the disease that we are talking here, and which is actually caused of a global concern, is COVID-19, which is a coronavirus infectious disease 19. The causative agent is novel coronavirus SARS-CoV-2. This is an electron microscope, scanning electron microscope picture, which is taken from NIH USA, which has been seen that this is the virus, how it looks like when it is infected the host in the pulmonary epithelial cells. Globally, this disease has been claiming lives with a huge rate of infection. Almost 8 million people have been in the confirmed cases, and there have been 400,000 recorded deaths till 20th June 2020. This is a bubble map which shows, which I had got from WHO, or the World Health Organization, and it shows that almost every country across the globe is affected due to this disease. In March 11, 2020, WHO officially declared COVID-19 as a global pandemic. Of course, we all know that India is also very badly affected, and we see in the recent context, we see that the cases have been on the rise since the month of February, March, April, and May. As you can see, it is still growing, and its cases continue to rise, infection rates continue to rise, even in India, which has affected us badly.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Please carry on. Due to some technical problem, she left us. Shortly, she will join us. Please wait. Bear with us. Shortly, she will join us.
Rihan, unake abar link pathao.
Yes, ma'am.
উনাকে আবার লিংক পাঠিয়ে দাও
ইয়া ইয়েস ইয়েস ম্যাম ইয়েস ম্যাম
Sorry for inconvenience. Shortly she will join us. Please stay with us. Shortly, she will join us. Ha, ki hocche, ma'am? না আপনি তো আগে জয়েন জয়েন করবেন তো আগে আপনি জয়েন করুন করে ঠিক আছে স্লাইড আপনি যদি যদি স্লাইডটা মানে আমি দেখছি কি আপনি আনমিউট স্লাইড দেখা যাচ্ছে কিন্তু আপনার আপনার ভয়েস মানে আনমিউট ছিল মানে মিউট ছিল আনমিউট করতে দরকার হ্যালো না না ঠিক আছে অসুবিধা নেই আপনি আবার আমি যে লিংক দিচ্ছি লিংকে দিয়ে ঢুকুন না আপনি ওকে 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 I'm extremely sorry. She left us due to some technical reason. Shortly, she will join us. Please be with us.
I got to get the microphone on.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, hear you, ma'am.
Okay, I just got the connection got off. So can you see the slide?
You have joined, ma'am. We are unable to see your slide or even you also.
I got a slide, so can you see it?
No, we are unable to either see you or your slide. And please, I'm requesting you, ma'am, please a little bit increase your voice. Yeah, now I can see, ma'am.
Okay.
Now we can see.
So can you see the screen now, Dr. Rehan?
Yeah, everything is fine, ma'am. Just increase your volume, ma'am. Everything is fine. Just you a little bit louder. Everything is fine. Go ahead, please.
Okay. So yes, we were discussing about the pandemic here and the situation in India where the cases are on the rise.
Yeah. Please carry on with a little bit louder sound, ma'am.
Okay. So are you able to see it?
Yeah, well, I hope you have joined by two link or two way. It's okay, ma'am. You carry on. Please, you carry on, ma'am.
Okay. So this is a group of the coronavirus. Can you hear? I mean, is it audible?
Yeah, it's audible, ma'am. It's better if you increase little bit more.
Okay.
But we are
okay.
It's still audible.
Okay. So the coronavirus here is a large family of the zoonotic viruses. It is under the order Nidovirales order with four genera, alpha, beta, gamma and delta. Now this is transmitted to the humans via the animal intermediaries and therefore it is a zoonotic kind of an infection. The beta coronavirus has seven groups or seven families under them, of four of them being very infectious forms, and they could cause disease only to the immunocompromised individuals, and three of them being the more severe and is very fatal to the human population. The coronavirus mediated disorders include the most fatal forms include the SARS-CoV, the MERS-CoV and the COVID-19. The SARS-CoV is a severe acute respiratory syndrome which had an outbreak in 2002 and 2003, and since its emergence in China, 26 countries had been affected with more than 8,000 cases in 2003, and it was the MERS-CoV which followed in 2012. It is a Middle East respiratory syndrome which made its appearance in the Middle East, and the mortality rate was 37%, while now we know about the COVID-19 where it is which had made its appearance in the Wuhan in district in China, and more than 400 deaths have happened. 400,000 deaths have happened till now. This is the image of the coronavirus, beta coronavirus particle, which is an enveloped, non-segmented, positively single-stranded ssRNA viral genome of size of about 29.9 kb, and this is the genome it looks like. Now, what is interesting over here are the different proteins that are on its surface. The most important being the spike protein or the S protein, which is basically a glycoprotein, and it has a receptor binding protein, and it can bind to the angiotensin converting enzyme 2 receptor or the ACE2 receptor on the host cell. So this is the molecule, this is the protein which is actually enabling the union of the virus or the entry of the virus into the host cell. The membrane proteins and the hemagglutinin esterase proteins are the other proteins on the surface. Now, what is interesting is that this genome of the SARS-CoV-2 is basically 96% identical to the bat coronavirus and 79.5% identical to the SARS coronavirus genome. So there are many questions now people raise that whether it is a man-made virus and how it came to the population. Well, how it came to the population and how it leaked into the population is still not known. Although we know it's a zoonotic type of an infection and it has moved from the animals to the human population. Now, sometime back during my PhD, I had worked with an interesting molecule which is nitroacetylsilic acid. This is a sugar molecule. Silic acid, this is basically the structure of the silic acid. And there are several modifications which can happen to silic acids. And one such modification is the 9-acetylsialic acid, which basically is also present on the surface of the coronavirus. And it is found that this sugar is actually helping in the infection of the virus to the human population. Now, this has been reported from the HCoV-OC43 coronavirus. This is a spike glycoprotein. And it is found to be very important. Now, this I will refer to this slide again later on, because now the recent development has been in this month to generate an antibody against this particular molecule. So it has been very interesting to see how we have progressed so far scientifically on this. Now, the animal origins of the human coronavirus. We are aware of the fact that the human coronavirus has appeared from the bat. So what has happened? It has moved from the species to species transmission has happened. So it's because it's a zoonotic infection. Bat, we know, is now the reservoir of all kinds of coronavirus. Now, how it has moved into the pangolin, how it has moved into the dromedary camels or into the civet cats is not known to us. This part is definitely a portion of biology, and a lot of research can be done in this domain. This pangolin is the carrier for the SARS-CoV-2, and that is how it infected an individual. And this infected individual has transmitted the disease to the entire population. So that is how the transmission is going on. So two phases of the disease transmission, the animal to the human transmission and the human to the human transmission. The other was the MERS-CoV, which had originated in the bat, and then to the dromedary camel, it had gone to the human population. Similarly, for the bats, it has gone to the civet cats, particularly for the case of the SARS-CoV, and it has gone to the human population. Now, when it has moved to the human-to-human transmission, that part has become also very important for us, because it could lead to acute infection like respiratory symptoms, atypical pneumonia, fever, dry cough, and progressive dyspnea, or shortness of breath, lung inflammation, acute respiratory distress syndrome, which is also called the ARDS, cardiac and renal injury. Some patients could also be asymptomatic or mildly ill. Now, the interesting thing is that the asymptomatic patients can also spread the infection. Now, how and why some patients are asymptomatic while some others are moderately affected, while some others are totally affected, is not known. That is also another domain of biology. The interesting minds could actually work on it, that these are the parts which are very important for us to know, that how and why these things are happening. Now, we all know that this transmission is primarily through the droplets. The infected individual pass on the droplets to the normal individual, and that's how they get infected. And also there is another mode of transmission through the mice. For example, there is a contaminated surface. We have known, there is a New England Journal of Medicine, there is a paper published very recently in the month of April, which says that it is more stable on plastic and stainless steel than on copper and then on cardboard. But definitely these are the places where this virus remains viable for 72 hours and is capable of infection. Okay, so one has to be aware of the fomites also. These are the fomites which enable this transmission. Although respiratory route is the most common method of transmission. Now, one important thing is that when somebody touches their fomites, when they touch their own mouth and nose with their contaminated hand, definitely that infection goes into the individual. And of course, the infection starts its own pathology and affects the individual badly. Now, it is also seen that the mortality and the morbidity rate is very much higher in those individuals who are suffering from comorbidities of lung disease, heart disease, diabetes, hypertension, etc. What is the hallmark of COVID-19 is that it is more contagious or more infectious than the others. Now, what is the unique viral nature of the viral transmission? It is incubation time of 4 to 7 days. So within 4 to 7 days, you will see the effects in an individual who is being affected by the disease. Now, another unique feature that has been observed is that lymphocytopenia, which means what? The T cell counts are reduced. So the CD4 and the CD8, now what is CD4? CD4 and CD8 are markers on the T cells. CD4 for the T helper cell and CD8 for the T cytotoxic cells. So these ratio could be very important. These are all cells of the adaptive immunity. I will just come into it in the next slide. These cells are very important, and if we try to monitor the ratio of the CD4 and CD8, we might be able to tell that which individuals are more at a higher risk and which are at a less higher risk or at a lesser risk for this kind of infection. So the T subcell ratio is very important with the neutrophil count. It's also predictive of the severe disease. Now, we have a hope here that in India, over 40% cases are getting recovered. And at this point, almost 150 vaccine candidates are under trial to induce immunity. So COVID-19, when we look into the immunopathological perspective, there are the two domains of immunology which we cannot oversee, which we have to look into it. One is the innate immunity, other one is the adaptive immunity. So the innate immunity comprises of certain cells like, for example, neutrophils, macrophages, dendritic cells, natural killer cells, while the adaptive immunity primarily, although there are many cells, I will not go into it, but many cells, many molecules, but the main important role is played by the T cells and the B cells over here. Now, these dendritic cells or the antigen-presenting cells over here, maybe the main classical antigen-presenting cells being the B cells, the dendritic cells, and macrophages. What happens is the antigen goes, for example, here it is the COVID-19, it could be any antigen also. So it is being taken up by this antigen-presenting cell. They are basically, it undergoes a pathway which is called the antigen presentation and processing pathway. So the antigen is processed, it's broken down into small fragments, and it is flagged by the MHC molecule, or the major histocompatibility molecule, on the surface. And this is being identified by a T cell. And accordingly, the T cell undergoes activation and leads to the formation of a T helper cell, T cytotoxic cell, and also the memory T cells. And later on, the TCTL, so the cytotoxic T cells, can kill the infection cell. So the another branch, this comprises the cell-mediated immunity. The other branch is a humoral immunity, where basically you have the B cells, and these B cells are also activated and gives rise to the memory B cell and the plasma cells. Now, as you all know, that plasma cells are the ones which release the antibodies. So any person who gets immune or who gets treated generates antibodies against this infection, and therefore that person is he can ward off the infection. So the innate and the adaptive immunity, again we have to come into it, that it takes several hours to grow. The 0 to 12 hours innate immunity function, which is the primary defense, followed by the adaptive immunity, which takes 1 to 7 days to develop. Now, innate immunity is what we have since our birth, while adaptive immunity is the one which is stimulated by exposure to microbes. So here you see the B cells producing the antibodies and the T cells. So these are my warriors which are actually helping me to get immunity or to get to combat the infection. Now look into this picture. This is a lung epithelial cell, which shows that the lung epithelial alveoli, which shows that this is a virus over here, and this virus is actually producing this, containing this PMPs and DMPs. Now what are PMPs? These are pathogen associated molecular patterns, and DMPs are damage associated molecular patterns. These are being identified by the macrophages. Now, once these are identified by the macrophages, they switch on the TLR mediated, inflammasome mediated activation pathways. And then what happens is there are release of a lot of cytokines, both autocrine and paracrine effects. And primarily in the case of the COVID-19, we find that the IL-6 and the IL-1 beta cytokine level getting high. Now, this leads to also recruitment of other cells over here. Now, because of all the cells, all the molecules that is going on, interaction, signaling interaction, which is going on over here, and the chemotaxis events which are happening here, what happens actually is there is kind of considerable tissue damage. Now, once there is a tissue damage, you can understand that this area gets filled up with cytokines, dead, damaged tissue parts, etc. So one method to stop this kind of infection would be an IL-6 blocker. There are two different IL-6 blockers, which I have written over here. And this IL-6 blocker is actually being used. So if the cytokine at this level could be blocked, then definitely the further tissue damage also can be blocked. And therefore, this infection could be warded off. That is one of the strategies. Now, two important strategies or two important observations are there by the several scientists who are working across the globe, that COVID-19 infection and pathology, there is a uniqueness. One is the hyperactivation of the innate immune response, and therefore what you see, the monocytes are getting activated, the macrophages are activated, and there is a release of the IL-6 and the IL-1 beta and the cytokine storm, while there is, on the other hand, there is a dysregulation of the adaptive immune response. Therefore, what is happening is your T cell count is going down. So the T cell, which is supposed to combat this infection, supposed to fight this infection, cannot fight anymore. So then what is happening is, because on one hand there is an extensive release of the IL-6, IL-1 beta, on the other hand the T cells are going down, this is leading to a complex immunological aspect in this disease. Now, if you look into this picture, it has been wonderfully shown that the yellow one is the viral load, the viral infection. Now, in case of a controlled acute viral infection, what happens is the innate system first gives the response, followed by the adaptive system. Okay. So then the T cells function, and ultimately, since the T cells are active, they ultimately give rise to that the infection can be controlled, the virus can be suppressed. But what happens in the case of an uncontrolled viral infection? See over here the green thing, it's an uncontrolled, it takes long time. So now, because it is an uncontrolled viral infection, the T cells here has got exhausted. Now once the T cells have got exhausted, what happens here is they are not able to function as they would have functioned earlier. So therefore, this leads to a very complicated situation, particularly in COVID-19 case also. So the most important event here is the cytokine storm and the lung damage. And what we can do over here is blocking the IL-6, blocking the IL-1, TNF, etc. There is a group of scientists who are working on the mesenchymal stem cell. Because there are a lot of tissue damage which is happening, people are suggesting that if mesenchymal stem cells could be given here and to prevent the tissue damage, that would be very helpful. This is a slide which shows the actual scenario, what is happening. Here we have the alveolus, and this alveolus has the type 1 alveolar cell and the type 2 alveolar cell, and this is a healthy alveolus basically. Now the SARS-CoV-2 makes its entry and makes its infection, and you see over here that because it has made its infection over here, the macrophages is active, and therefore a lot of cytokines have been released, and this has led to peeling off of the alveolar portion. So now what is happening is this is a moderate infection, we can say. Why? Because there is still some space, this person can breathe, and probably some kind of drug or some kind of therapy could help you out over here. Even ventilators would be helpful. But look at the case over here where this process continues and the lung alveoli gets completely clogged. Then this is the case where very rarely something can be done for the individual and finally he succumbs. So that is the pathophysiology of COVID-19, what is happening and what we are seeing as of now. So what is the strategy, or what could be the strategy for combating this infection? Well, we know that we have to boost our adaptive immune system. We have to boost our T cells. We have to get them into function. And therefore, the one strategy could be to stop the IL-6, to stop the IL-1, block it, give corticosteroids to stimulate the T cell survival. Okay, and therefore, both my adaptive immunity and the innate immunity can be improved, and therefore I can combat the both parts of the system. Now I had referred to the major histocompatibility complex a few slides ago. Major histocompatibility complex are very essential molecules in the adaptive immunity, because they are the ones who present the antigen, present the epitopes to the T cells, MHC class 1 as well as the MHC class 2. Now what has happened is that supposing an individual has MHC, which can actually be more showing more affinity to bind towards the COVID-19 peptides. And what happens is that person is more immune to it, because more and more the MHC will flag that kind of peptide, and therefore that person has more immunity as compared to the others. In the Indian population, it has been found that there is a huge HLA diversity, and this HLA diversity could actually be helpful in our case in conferring us immunity. This has been seen in several diseases like tuberculosis, leprosy, HIV, hepatitis B, influenza, and this has been associated with specific HLA haplotypes. So this is also very important. The HLA molecule with increased binding specificity of SARS-CoV-2 virus peptide is always an advantage for that individual. We observe low infection rates in India. There is only 6% needs hospitalization, less than 5.5% needs ventilator support, fewer severe cases and fewer death. That is probable because of the broad-based immunity in the Indian due to the exposure to microbial load, extensive HLA diversity, which people are now looking across the globe, that probably HLA diversity is a key tool why different countries are showing different characteristics of the infection rate, and environmental factors and food habits. Professor N.K. Mehra, he had published a very nice paper in Indian Journal of Chemical Biochemistry about the HLA genes and their diverse polymorphism, and it actually shows that this could be a very nice tool in combating this infection. Now the question is, since vaccines are a little bit later and we are not able to develop vaccine immediately, but of course it will take time, people are working on it, I will come to it in the next slide, whether herd immunity would be a good option in the case of COVID-19. What is herd immunity? Herd immunity is basically when one person is immunized and that person is left into the population so that he becomes kind of a blocker to the passage of the infection to the other individual. sometimes it can be used to prevent the second wave of infection. This is a strategy in several disorders where the immediate vaccination is not possible. But in COVID-19 case, such a kind of step is not a very welcome step. So the other methods of social distancing, wearing a mask, changed lifestyle is perhaps a better method to combat this infection. Next is, there are certain drugs, for example, hydroxychloroquine and hydroxychloroquine. Now, this importance of these two drugs over here is that it is blocking the virus receptor binding and the virus endosomfusion. This is very important because if you can block this interaction, then definitely the chances of infection is less. Okay. The other molecules, other important agents are to prevent the cytokine storm, like for example, the IL-6 antagonist, granulocyte colony stimulating factor, GNS-CSF inhibitor, IL-1 antagonist, IL-17 antagonist, anti-tumor necrosis factors. So these are all given with the aim of combating the cytokine storm. And the other aim is to block the entry of the virus into the host cell. Now, there are an array of different vaccines which are being done across the globe, there are several companies, there are several R&D, several labs which are actually working on it, with the different array of vaccines. And those include like weakened virus or inactivated forms of virus. But of course, we do not know which is the appropriate strategy, and it would take time to actually find out. Now, whether one vaccine would be sufficient or it would differ in the different countries, that is also remains a major portion of debate that we have to check, and the clinical trials can only answer to that. There are the DNA vaccines, there are the RNA vaccines, and could be DNA. Also, there could be the protein subunits which could be acted as vaccines, and there could be virus-like particles that could be designed also to act as vaccines. Now, I had referred to a nimoacetylsilic acid, a sugar molecule, a silic acid molecule in my previous slide, that is helping the spike protein to bind to the host. So now what happens is there has been an antibody. It's a very recent paper in Nature, in May, which shows that there could be an antibody against this epitope, and it is found to be useful, particularly in a laboratory study. Of course, we have to check, or further studies have to be checked in the population how it comes out. But this humanized antibody is a very welcome step, because if that could be stopped, then definitely the further infection also can be stopped. Now, what is our path ahead? We have known this. Now, what is our path ahead? Our path ahead is mainly the diagnostics. We are improving the diagnostics. There are PCR-based methods, antibody-based methods, CRISPR technology-based genome editing tools. Vaccines, of course, will confer the long-term immunity, and earliest by 12 to 18 months, it should come into place. But it would take time, and of course, as I told you, which is the right strategy is still to be determined. It's still to be checked which is the best vaccine. Treatments to save the lives, trials. Yes, for several drugs, trials have been started. Now, there are several research and development. Yes, of course, COVID-19 has given us a very nice opportunity, for further research, because there are some unanswered questions in biology. For example, how and why the transmission has happened from the bat to the other animal to the human is not known. Then the question is, people can look into it. People are looking into it. Evolutionary biologists actually are working on it. You are the students, so you are our future tomorrow, and you also can think that why this thing is happening, and ultimately we can get a very nice solution if you properly think at it, that why this kind of things happen, why a person is asymptomatic, why the asymptomatic pathophysiology is very different from the symptomatic individuals, and what are the biomarkers to understand the susceptibility of infection, whether there will be reinfection, and who are the individuals who will get the reinfection, who are less susceptible to reinfection. Then, for example, there is a big issue of climate change, as you are aware of it. Now, how climate change affects this pandemic is also a very important question, which even we are asking at our level, that particularly I am asking along with my students, that how it actually goes, how our pandemics are actually affected by climate change. Because if you remember, in 1901, the climate was quite different from that what is today. But still we are having pandemics, still these are claiming lives. So whether these have some kind of effect on the zoonotic infections is a question that we are posing at this point. Of course, social impact is a very important concern over here. There are social awareness of do's and don'ts. For example, India government has made the MHRD, has been working very hard. All the governments across the states as well as our West Bengal government has been working very hard to convince people to spread the news, to spread the, to take the social awareness measures. Of course, information resource is very important there. We have to follow the rules and laws, and definitely to combat this infection, this is very, it should be very rigorous and it should be followed very nicely. Also, DIFR is another autonomous body of DAE, like us, like NICER. DIFR is another autonomous body, and there they have released the COVID GAN. You can go to the website and have a look. There is the COVID Katha also. It is a multimedia guide for mass awareness and by DST or the Department of Science and Technology. And there is a Ministry of Ayush who is looking into if some kind of natural resources could be used or to combat this infection. Because those are very important from the point of view that they are our traditional medicine, as well as they help us, they are with lesser side effects as compared to the other drugs. Now, there is still hope with the COVID-19 case, although I know it has broken down economics, people have survived, people have really faced a tough time with so many jobs which have been gone, and we had to readjust our labs, our systems, our education systems, our children. They could not go to school, so there are so many grievances from everywhere, and everywhere people are very sad about whatever is going on. And still there is hope, because at the end of the day, we have to be hopeful for a better tomorrow. And 17 of the oldest people in the world have beaten COVID-19. 104-year-old Spanish flu survivor has become also a COVID-19 survivor. So this is really good that the old people are also able to combat the infection, and it's nothing to fear. Of course, the TIFR has published very nicely a nice cartoon. It says that which of the superheroes should get COVID-19? Not the ones who have, you know, face masks, but the ones who basically has covered their nose and mouth are the ones who will be safe in the COVID-19. So I remember Perry Puri always, and what she said years together ago is also valid today, that nothing in life is to be feared. It is only to be understood. Now it is the time to understand more so that we fear less. So first and foremost, we have to say goodbye to our fear and we have to move ahead. Although, and try our best to combat the infection, prevent the social passage of the infection, follow all possible rigorous measures so that the infection doesn't spread to the community, as well as scientific community is working very hard so that this infection could be stopped and people could be cured and people could lead a better life and everything could be restored to a new normal. I would acknowledge the National Institute of Science, Education and Research, NICER, Bhubaneswar, India, Department of Atomic Energy, Government of India, Bhumi Bhava National Institute of HBNI, Mumbai, to whom we are affiliated to, the principal, Dinalal Mazumdar Memorial College for Women, Bhubaneswar, Kolkata, for allowing me to talk in this forum. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Thanks a lot, ma'am, for a wonderful presentation. Really, I'm mesmerized by your presentation. The way you explain the journey of COVID in human, in the light of immunology and molecular biology, hope each one of us enjoyed and learned a lot by your presentation. Seriously, once again, thanks a lot, ma'am, for this kind, very informative presentation. And in my, you know, while your presentation, the most of, you know, a student, you know, they ping me in my personal chat. They want to hear your slide. So I'm really in front of everyone. I'm request you. It would be better to allow us this slide to share with the student, and as well as if it's better if you can allow us to upload the same one in our college portal, because it's a very informative information which whatever you have given. So finally, thanks, and thanks a lot, ma'am.
Dr. Rehan, may I request Dr. Ghosh to send the slides to your mail or a seminar mail? Because students and teachers, they will be very much benefited from her presentation.
Exactly, ma'am, exactly. Hope Shivashri ma'am is there.
Please share it with you so everybody can have a look at it.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Once again, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now
so much.
Now I Now I would like to request Dr. Lipika Malik ma'am to conclude the session, successively give word of thanks for today's speaker. Please, Lipika ma'am is there.
Good afternoon all. Thanksgiving session. Now I am starting. The best and beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or even touched. They must be felt by heart. Thank you is one such prayer among them. I consider it a great privilege to propose a vote of thanks to all dignitaries who have made it as a memorable and successful event. Today, my words are not enough to express the gratitude. On behalf of our college, I would like to thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Sir Professor Bashwap Chowdhury, who graced us with his thought-provoking address, setting a perfect platform for the webinar. I would like to thank our beloved principal for all words of wisdom that radiated a source of energy within us. We will ever remain grateful to you, and we thank you for being with us in all our endeavors. Heartfelt thanks goes out to all our faculties and teachers of the Department of Zoology, whose tireless effort has made this event a grand success. Thanks are too little an expression to acknowledge the efforts of Dr. Indrajit Bishas, Dr. S. Rehan Ahmed, Dr. Anindya Sundar Bhuiya, Sri Ritik Acharya, Sri Shantanu Das, and Srimati Rituparna Maiti. An event of this dimension cannot happen overnight. The wheels start rolling months in advance. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of very motivated and dedicated members of our webinar committee, and especially its convener, Sri Pradipta Mukherjee, technical faculties, cum assistants, Sri Ritik Acharya, Srimati Atri Bhattacharya, Pooja Das. I cannot thank everyone enough for the involvement they have shown and the willingness they have expressed to take on the completion of tasks beyond their comfort zones. I convey my thanks and gratitude to all the respected governing body members, and most importantly, President Sir of our governing body, Sri Madan Mitra, for active support and cooperation. I thank all the participants present here. Thank you again.
May I take the privilege to convey my thanks to Dr. Shamasri Ghosh again, because I am not from zoology, neither from any science stream, but her deliberations was so wonderful that it touched my heart and brain. So I'm really indebted to Dr. Ghosh for sparing some of her valuable time for us. I always also convey my thanks to our Vice Chancellor, Professor Bashwap Chowdhury, who has always extended his cooperation to all our endeavor. I'm handing it over to the Department of Zoology.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Now I would like to remind my all participants, tomorrow's timing is 10:30. So must remember, tomorrow timing is reversed from today, because today we have started at 1 p.m. But tomorrow, as one speaker from US is going to be joined, so that is why we are able to do or start the session by 2 or 1. So tomorrow, get ready at 10:30. So till then, thank you. Thank you very much.